Welcome to our first presentation of this new year. I'd like to acknowledge once again our funders, the Cleveland Foundation, the Mount Sinai Foundation, and the DiOrio Foundation from Youngstown that have been funding our meetings and our organization. I have a few announcements before I get to introduce our wonderful speaker today. So first of all, to remind you that we already have scheduled our next speaker, and there is a handout,
oh, here it is,
that you can take with you, and if you're on our mailing list, you'll get it also in the mail, which is November 14th, Ricardo Dolmetsch, who is an assistant professor at Stanford University and a neuroscientist, will be coming. The handout, and also when you get the email, will connect you. Ricardo is a very interesting guy, and this is a combined presentation with the Department of Neurosciences. There's an interview of Ricardo with the head of the NIMH, Tom Insel, in which he talks about the fact that he is a neuroscientist, but he also has a child with autism, and how that has really spurred him on into trying to understand what's going on in a very different level. So I think you'll find him very interesting. Our second announcement is that while she's not here today, Jessica Taylor is the new president of Autism Speaks University. And Anastasia Dimitropoulos. Anastasia, are you here? Oh, there she is. Anastasia is our professor of psychology, who is one of the sponsors of the group. Last year, you may remember Maria Lemler went on to Vanderbilt to take a special education program in autism. And we also have another student here, part of Autism Speaks, and I forgot Beth, right? Sarah. You want to stand up a minute? We just had a presentation that Anastasia's group and Sarah and Jessica put on, a panel presentation last week or 2 weeks ago. Since there's a great deal of interest by our students and students all across the country at the undergraduate and graduate level about research and work in autism spectrum disorders. So that's really moving along. I also want you all to meet Janet Coquelette. Janet, some of you will be hearing from Janet. She'll be coming around to interview you. Janet, we are putting together our plans for the two foundations, and Janet is a consultant, also an attorney, who has worked with us at CASE on a number of programs, who will be helping us pull together all of the things that we've done over the last year as we put together our final reports to those foundations. So a few other announcements. One, we have a website. I don't know if all of you have gone on the website, but you can see we are now video recording our presentations, and the first one that we did was Nancy Minshew, so you can go on and you can really see her presentation again if you missed it while she was here. And you'll be able to see Dr. Fisher's presentation today as well. Couple of big announcements, I think, that you'll hopefully be reading about. First of all, we now have the labs from the Cleveland Clinic, Lerner College of Medicine. Dr. Karis Eng's lab is working with Dr. David Katz's lab together. And they are also forming a journal club, which you'll be hearing about and be getting information about to join. So that's a very exciting development. Second of all, you'll be seeing, hopefully soon, a press release about a consortium that's being formed, and also it's being funded through the Cleveland Clinic Lerner Research Institute and the research vice president of research at Case Western Reserve to form a patient consortium and a biorepository that will help bring all of, develop a common assessment program so that we can develop a research protocol that actually can use patients, which is really needed. You need to have a patient registry that's really regional, not just in one lab or one hospital that will be there. So this is really great that we have joint funding from both of those places. Also, I'd like to draw your attention to two really important papers that Dr. Katz has that will be published this month. The first, in the Journal of Neuroscience, is demonstrating the reversibility of symptoms in a mouse model of Rett syndrome using a treatment strategy that's a medication that may be applicable to non-syndrome autism as well. And the second is a paper written in collaboration with the NIH, which is a comprehensive review of preclinical research in Rett syndrome that defines strategies and guidelines for translating basic science finding into clinical trials. And that's, you know, there's such a broad area of work, and what we really want to do is bring the research and the clinical together across multiple ways. So those are some really, having started out not that long ago, to see all these collaborations begin to take place is very exciting for me, and I hope for you. So now to our speaker. We're very lucky today to have Dr. Wayne Fisher. Dr. Wayne Fisher has been the director of the Center for Autism Spectrum Disorders at the Munroe-Meyer Institute at the University of Nebraska Medical Center and its Department of Behavioral Genetics since October of 2005. Prior to this, he's also the Munroe Professor of Behavioral Research there. Prior to this, Dr. Fisher was a professor of psychiatry at Johns Hopkins, and he served there as the executive director for neurobehavioral programs at the Kennedy Krieger Institute. And more recently, the Kennedy Krieger Institute developed a collaboration or a working relationship with the Marcus Institute in Atlanta, and Dr. Fisher and his wife worked there for several years before going on to Omaha. Dr. Fisher is the past editor for the Journal of Applied Behavior Analysis. He's a recipient of the Bush Leadership Award. He received the award for distinguished contribution to applied behavioral search from the Behavior Analysis Division of the American Psychological Association. Dr. Fisher has co-authored over 115 research articles on severe behavior disorders among children with autism and with developmental disabilities and other topics, and he goes literally all over the world consulting in this area. He currently has grants from the National Institute of Mental Health to study the functions of aberrant behavior displayed by children with autism. He is training teams of clinical researchers at the Center for Autism Spectrum Disorders in Omaha, has developed multiple programs, worked with the insurance companies to get clinical services for the kids and the adults with these disorders. We're very, very lucky to have Dr. Fisher here today, and I'd like you to welcome him before he speaks.
This is very exciting to come and talk with you folks about all the things that are going on here and being able to help at the start of something that I think is going to be really great and really big. Thank you for that introduction. Some people think that I've done a lot of things. It's really that I just can't hold a job. The area that I work in is in children with severe behavior disorders and children with autism. And I work with those kids from a behavioral perspective of learning about and trying to understand behavior within its environmental context. And to explain that, I have a little story I like to tell, is that there was this man walking through the woods, and he sees something on the ground, picks it up, starts rubbing it, and it turns out to be a lamp. And as he rubs it, a genie comes out, and the genie says, "I've been stuck in that bottle for 3,000 years, and for your reward for releasing me, I grant you three wishes. What would you like?" And the man said, "Well, you know, I've really had a lot of health problems lately. My knees are bad, my heart's bad. The doctors say he doesn't know how long that heart's going to last. It'd be kind of nice to be healthy and feel better." And the genie goes, "Poof, your wish is granted. What's your second wish?" And the guy says, "Well, I've always been very poor, never been able to travel, never been able to do things, and it'd be nice to have a little bit of money." The genie goes, "Poof, your wish is granted. What's your final wish?" And the guy thought hard and long, and finally he said, "Well, you know, it'd be really nice if my sex life would improve a bit." And the genie goes, "Poof, your wish is granted." So about a month later, the guy's walking through the same woods, and he comes upon the genie, and the genie says, "Well, how did the three wishes go? The guy says, great. I went to the doctor this week, and he said, you're perfect. Clean bill of health. My heart's great. My knees are great. I've never felt better. He says, what about your second wish? He said, well, amazing thing. Apparently, I had this distant uncle who was filthy rich, and he died and left me a fortune. Now I can travel, do whatever I want, buy whatever I want. The genie said, well, what about your final wish? He said, oh, that's the best one of all. I'm having sex every other week or so. And the genie kind of scratched his head and said, sex every other week or so, that usually my wishes come out a little bit better than that. And the guy said, well, it's not bad for a priest in a small town. My apologies to any Catholics in the group. I was actually told that joke by a priest, so. But the point is that we have to understand behavior in the context in which it occurs. And that's really the focus of the type of research I do. Our center, just to tell you a little bit about it, is designed to provide comprehensive state-of-the-art clinical services to advance knowledge about the causes of and treatments for autism spectrum disorders through systematic research, and also to disseminate information about effective assessments and treatments through education, professional training, and consultation. The center has several components. We have about now five faculty and 55 staff, trainees, postdocs, pre-docs, and PhD students. We have a severe behavior program that brings kids in on an intensive outpatient or day treatment model. The autism diagnostic clinic, we see about 250 kids per year. Roughly 50 to 60% of those kids end up with a diagnosis on the autism spectrum. Our early intervention program has about 20 to 25 kids at any given point in time receiving intensive early intervention. And then we have a virtual care program that was started based on a grant from the Department of Defense. And the goal of this is to show that we can develop systematic methods for training parents, for training paraprofessionals, and then ways of supervising ongoing treatment and intervention over long distances using virtual care and telehealth techniques. And that program and that grant is ongoing. We also have a PhD program that we started 3 years ago, in which we're focusing on training people in autism and the treatment of autism with applied behavior analysis. We have our folks come in, they have ongoing coursework, didactic instruction, and then they work in our labs and our programs and apply what they learn in the classroom almost immediately. And we've been very happy with how that's going. We give the students a stipend of about $21,500 for the 20 hours that they devote to working with us on research and clinical service. And then for that, they also receive a full tuition waiver. So it's a way for students to go through the program, get high-quality training, and end up with a PhD without having to borrow huge amounts of sums through student loans and that sort of thing. My wife runs the Pediatric Feeding Disorders Program, which is very similar in terms of its model, the personnel. We share staff back and forth, cover each other in terms of faculty, so she's covering for me while I'm out of town. Also has a day treatment component, an outpatient component. The University of Nebraska Medical Center has one of the top small bowel liver transplant programs intestinal rehab program, and almost all of those kids have severe feeding problems, and so that's been a very nice collaboration between her program and that existing program. And then she also has folks in our PhD program. Now, autism was once thought to be a form of schizophrenia, was called childhood schizophrenia, but it differs from schizophrenia in all of the major components that make up a syndrome, and those include the symptoms, age of onset, family history, etiology, and response to treatment. And we define autism in terms of markedly abnormal or impaired development in three major areas. These kids have significant difficulties with social interaction, with language and communication, and also have markedly restricted interest activities and behaviors. But as a colleague of mine once put, definitions are cheap and explanations are dear, and it's very important not to confuse the two. A very common thing that we see in this field, and I have been guilty of it myself, is that we see kids that have this triad of symptoms and language problems, repetitive behaviors, difficulties in interacting, turn-taking, social interaction. And we diagnose the child as having autism, and then a parent asks us, why is my child doing this weird thing? And we say it's because the child has autism. We can't both define the syndrome in terms of certain behaviors and then explain those behaviors by saying the person has the syndrome. We have to look deeper, and the two major areas that I think are important are in the kind of neuroscience, bio, and genetics of the disorder, but also in terms of how the individual interacts with their environment and how can we use what we know about learning and behavior in the environment to improve outcomes for these individuals. Autism spectrum disorders are, again, characterized by severe problems in those three major areas. Currently, the diagnostic criteria divide them into these five areas, and in the next rendition of the DSM-5, autistic disorder, Asperger's disorder, and PDD-NOS are going to be combined. There's pretty good data to say that that's a good thing to do, but probably over time we also have to think about ways in which of grouping and subtyping kids that are on the spectrum, hopefully according to genetics and etiology, so that we can start to tailor interventions more specifically according to the individual's genotype. And that was one of the reasons that we were recruited to Nebraska, because they have an excellent genetics lab and excellent genetics people there. And we hope that over time we'll be able to collaborate to a point where we can start to develop genetic syndrome-specific interventions, because a child who has autism because they have Fragile X syndrome may require a different drug treatment and or a different behavioral intervention than someone who has autism because of a deletion on chromosome 15 or some other reason. And so I think the grouping of kids more broadly in the spectrum phenotypically makes sense, but we also need to think about why these kids have these, what is the pathophysiology of their disorder, and how can that be used to inform our interventions. Autism is typically diagnosed within the first 3 years. The median prevalence estimate is 1 in 162 kids, and it's 4 times more common in boys than girls. But some recent prevalence studies suggest that the prevalence may be much, much higher, so that most prevalence studies are constructed in a way that individuals go out and try to capture or find all of the diagnosed cases. Several real well-controlled studies have taken a different approach, where they have screened an entire population, kids between the ages so-and-so and so-and-so, and those that then screen positive are worked up, given a diagnostic assessment, to actually see how many kids fit the diagnosis. And at least with these three studies, the prevalence rates are coming out 2 to 3 times as high as other types of studies, which suggests that if you just count the kids that have already been referred, you get one number. If you actually go out and look and say how many kids actually meet diagnostic criteria, you may get a much higher number. And so as much as we've been concerned about what the prevalence of autism is and how it's grown over the last 20 years, we may be grossly underestimating it. And so what are these kids? The kids that are getting picked up that don't get diagnosed are the kids that go to school. They get pretty good grades, but they don't have many friends. They don't know how to interact with people. They may have repetitive activities and interests, but it doesn't interfere with kind of getting through the day and getting through school. But they may be kids that could benefit from help and intervention nevertheless. Another important thing that's come out recently is the recurrence risk among siblings. If an older sibling has autism, an autism spectrum disorder, the risk of a younger brother is about 1 in 4, fairly high. The risk of a younger sister is much, much higher than it is in the general population of females at 1 in 11. Another issue that we have to come to terms with is just how big of a problem this is and how much effort we're putting towards solving it. And things are getting better, but they're not where they should be at this point in time. When compared to other serious childhood conditions, autism is much more common, but fewer dollars are spent per case on autism than those other conditions. And this just shows the prevalence of autism, and this is, again, a fairly conservative estimate of the prevalence, in relationship to juvenile diabetes, muscular dystrophy, leukemia, and cystic fibrosis. And it is 10 times more common than these other conditions combined. But when we look at the amount of research dollars spent per autism on a per case basis, saying here's how many dollars divided by here are how many kids are affected. When you look at it on a per case basis, we're way, way, way down at the bottom. Another issue that's getting better but still is a big problem is that kids with autism frequently are not covered by insurance. And so this cartoon says, unfortunately, you have what we call no insurance, which translates to no treatment. And in Nebraska, it is not uncommon for a child to get diagnosed, for them to get referred for treatment. The parent gets the child involved in speech and language therapy, occupational therapy, applied behavior analysis, and for the bills to start to pile up, they get sent to the insurance company. The insurance company denies it. They get resent. And that process, before the parent finally gets an explanation of benefits, can take 6 months or more. And then they may have thousands of dollars in bills that they thought your insurance was at least going to cover some of it, and it doesn't. And so that can be a really big problem. Now, one of the things that is really striking about these kids with autism is that they don't learn social behavior naturally through kind of everyday interactions. And it is something that is so universal in most other people and in other species that I think it's one of the most striking things about this condition. And I show this slide just to show how, you know, even animals of different species tend to figure out how to interact socially with one another. Humans do it as well. But it's something that just does not come easy, does not come naturally for kids on the autism spectrum. So again, looking at what should we be looking for in terms of understanding this, and one major area is in the genetics of autism. We know that autism clearly runs in families. The heritability index is somewhere between 80 and 90%, depending on how you calculate it. Individuals that are identical twins or monozygotic twins, the concordance rate varies from about 60% to as many close to 100%. It is at or close to 60% when you say for accordance to occur, one twin has autism and the other twin also has to have the same diagnosis of autism. If you say one child has autism, in order for us to count it as concordance, the other child is on the broad autism phenotype or spectrum, then the concordance rate goes up to close to 100%. Among dizygotic twins, the concordance rate is also higher than what would be expected by chance, which means that probably we need to be definitely looking at genetics, but also looking at potential environmental factors that may be interacting with genetics. And so with that kind of introduction, excuse me, I'd like to talk a little bit about what we do in our research at our center, especially in the behavioral side, and how we do that, and really try to focus on the translational aspects of our work. I kind of totally rearranged my slides this morning, in part because of the talk with folks last night. And as I've learned about what you have here currently, it's clear that you have exceptional basic scientists and lots of resources there, and you have really exceptional clinical programs for kids on the autism spectrum. And I think in terms of building your center and thinking about it, trying to look at translational research as kind of the glue to pull those things together is probably an area that you guys should give considerable amount of thought to. And so I wanted to talk a little bit about how we've done a little bit of that in our center and our work. Just in general, the kids that we see, about 50% of the kids with autism who have no more than mild mental retardation, who receive early intensive behavioral intervention, reach a point where they can be educated in regular classrooms with minimal assistance. And this just shows data from a number of studies. There's actually more, and I need to update this graph. But this just looks at the hours per week of treatment and its correlation with increases in IQ scores. And basically, the correlation is almost 0.8, very high. And what this means is more is better. But there's also this clustering around 25 hours per week, and that's where that recommendation probably came from, but it's not exactly clear. And another aspect that I wanted to emphasize is as you start to think about building your programs, what you want to do is, if possible, start to think about how can we collect data in a systematic way, because that's going to further the research, and everybody thinks about it that way, that if we can be good clinicians and collect good data, we can put it into a repository, and then the researchers can come in and comb that and learn things. Well, there's also an important factor on the other side, and that is that integrating research with your clinical work increases the outcomes for your patients. I'll say that again. Increasing the systematic way you approach your clinical work not only helps research, it also improves the clinical outcomes you produce for your patients. So our philosophy in our center is that everybody comes through the door, we want to use our absolute best techniques. And those are techniques, and for us, it's involved using single case research designs and using very systematic and reliable data collection procedures, and showing that our treatments are what is causing the person to change their behavior. When I first took over the neurobehavioral units at the Kennedy Krieger Institute, it was not uncommon for somebody to come in, be in that therapeutic milieu for a period of time, get discharged, and their behavior to fall apart a week or so after they were discharged from the hospital. And why? Because we didn't figure out what was controlling their behavior. We didn't systematically assess that. We didn't prove that that was the case. And then use things that were also going to work once the child went back into the home. Over time, we developed those systems and got better and better at it. And now, in that program and the one in Marcus and also in ours, we were able to reduce problem behavior by about 90% on average. And when we discharge people, we follow them typically for about a 2-year period of time post-discharge, and only 5% regress to a point where they have to be readmitted to the intensive program. And that all came from really using data to figure out what's working and what's not working. And there's also been a meta-analysis recently by Didden and colleagues that basically show that same phenomena. When they looked at a whole bunch of variables in the literature, focusing mostly on treatment of severe behavior disorders with the data that's usually published with single case designs, that is the cases that where they use the most methodological rigor not only had the best research but produced the best clinical outcomes. Exactly the same thing that I was telling you. Okay, so in terms of thinking about melding research and our clinical work, this is one of the areas I'm trying to work a decent transition. This wasn't going to be the next slide in the original talk, but one of the areas that we focus on with kids with autism, and there's been a fair amount of basic research in neuroimaging and also just in phenotyping on how much difficulty kids with autism have with understanding and recognizing the emotions of others, being able to read somebody's reaction to what they're doing. It's a big area of concern, and there really isn't a lot of treatment or intervention data on this particular topic. And so we set out to start some research in that area. And we had three goals. We had two goals initially. It was develop an assessment to determine whether a child shows a deficit in recognizing and labeling emotions relative to actions. And if you look at the kind of phenotyping developmental research in this area, typically what they do is give kids pictures of individuals expressing different emotions or doing different actions, and there's normative data on this. And what you see is, on average, the kids do at or close to grade level, if they're matched on IQ or something like that, in terms of recognizing somebody's actions, throwing a ball, jumping, whatever it is. But when you have them look at faces expressing emotion or somebody acting out an emotion, they tend to have much more difficulty with that. And so our goal was to look at this research and say, is there something that we can do to incorporate that information for an individualized assessment for a child with autism to decide, is this somebody that needs specialized help or work in training emotion recognition? And so that was the first goal. And then the second thing was, well, can we come up with an effective behavioral intervention that might help somebody increase their skills in emotion recognition? And then the third thing that kind of happened as a nice sideline was to look at whether or not this was, we think about kids with autism may not learn about emotions simply because it's not an interest, kind of a motivational aspect. And then the other thing is perhaps there is, it's a more of a learning disability, learning deficit, that this is just more tough for them to learn about and understand. And so we think that we haven't got much data on this so far, but we think that this is a potential avenue of future research in this area, and I'll explain that as we go along. Our first study on this involved just three kids. They had a little bit of spoken language, but nothing in terms, not much in terms of, one had a little bit of reciprocal conversation. And we set up our targets, and we hadn't done this before, so we did it two ways. We had 2D emotions and actions, basically pictures of people doing things or pictures of people expressing emotions. And we also had 3D, which in this case, it was just in vivo or live. The therapist actually acted out the actions or acted out the emotions. And basically, in the assessment, we just said, how does this person feel or what's this person doing? And we had no programmed reinforcement or no training. And I won't go through this graph in detail, but basically where we saw the biggest difference is our red bars are 2D actions, our gray bars are 2D emotions, fairly similar to what we saw in the phenotyping literature. And so that's where we started our intervention. And this is just where we got a whole bunch of emotion and action targets. We started training those, and we saw the same sort of pattern. They did much better with the actions, which are these darker markers, and the emotions much lower in all three participants. We then started our intervention. This first set of bars is just where we're doing what we call a 0 second time delay. We're telling the answer every time for a few sessions, and then we start giving them chance to answer independently, and this is their increases in their independent responding. And what you see is everybody gets up to 100% correct, but you also see it seems to take a little bit longer for the emotions relative to the actions, but we weren't sure if that was just because they started out with differences in baseline, that they could do better with the actions than emotions before we started the training. So the next thing we did was to look at how hard was it to teach these things. And we looked at the individual items, and what this is these are all the items where the individual was at 0% correct during our initial assessment. They never got it right. And we had our trials to criterion as our determination, and five trials to criterion is what we consider mastery. If they got five in a row correct, and what you see is the gray bars are the actions, and these were ones that they didn't know in baseline. And in every case, they learned it almost immediately. Five, most seven or eight error correction trials. And the black bars, you see, could take sometimes four or five times as many trials to learn an action or emotion that basically across people would be on the same developmental level, same difficulty level. So we think that this suggests that this may be more than just a motivational problem, because we've done a systematic training procedure. We assess what's going to motivate them. We get in order to do this training, we get motivation really, really high. And so it really looks like these are learning about emotions seem to be more difficult, at least for these first three kids. And our second study, we, given that this was kind of a serendipitous finding, we started out with a group of kids where we just selected all emotions and all actions as targets where they were at zero correct during the baseline. And so we had more exemplars of actions that they didn't know, and have essentially replicated these findings. So just to review those results, all participants labeled actions with greater accuracy than emotions during baseline. All of them acquired all of the actions and all the emotions that we're teaching, but it seemed to take the kids with autism more time and more trials to learn actions that they didn't know initially than to learn emotions. Or I'm sorry, the other way around, learn emotions that they didn't know rather than actions. And so this would be an example where we looked at some basic research on differences in phenotypes between kids with autism and controls, and then said, how can we use that kind of basic research to produce a treatment intervention that specifically targets this. How do we assess whether the children need this on an individual basis? And if they need this, what's the intervention? And that's how this study came about. The next area I want to talk about is our treatment of kids with severe behavior problems, aggression, self-injury, property destruction, that sort of thing. And to give you an idea of the kind of severity level, this is a young lady who we treated on the neurobehavioral unit, inpatient unit at the Kennedy Krieger Institute. And she came in on her first day. She hit herself or banged her head 20,932 times on that very first day. We decided we were going to end baseline after that point. It's really a rare individual we see that does this type of behavior across all conditions and all environmental situations, and she's kind of the exception that proves the rule. That is, typically we see these behaviors occur under certain conditions and are much lower under other conditions, and that's where our environmental interventions can use that information, and that's what I'll be talking about. There's a young lady with Cornelia de Lange syndrome, much different presentation. She would go a week, 2 weeks, sometimes longer, with no self-injurious behavior at all, and then would become very agitated, lots of vocalizations, she was nonverbal, decreased sleep, hyperactivity, looked like kind of a nonverbal presentation of mania. But the most significant thing is that she would seek out and bang her head against hard objects, and she did this by banging her head against the faucet on a tub. And as bad as that looked, the real risk was that she was compromising her skull and was at risk of death as a result of that. All right.
This video shows Dylan, a 7-year-old with autism and severe self-injurious behavior. The video was made by Dylan's parents to show how severe behavior disorders negatively impact the child and his or her family, and also show how effective treatment can dramatically improve their lives. Dylan was literally attached to his mother all of the time. She couldn't put him down to go to the bathroom or even to go to sleep. They were physically attached like this because whenever she put him down, he engaged in self-injurious behavior. As an example, she is now going to try and put him down for a few minutes so she can make lunch. As you can see, he immediately displays severe self-injurious behavior.
A general idea of what he does. This is typical behavior. A lot of times I do sit him in the chair, but he just continues to hit himself and kick and slap and stuff. These are holes in the walls that Dylan just did recently.
These are hard plastic walls, and Dylan has to bang his head exceedingly hard to produce these holes. Headbanging of this intensity over time can result in brain damage or detached retinas and blindness. This scene shows how these destructive behaviors affect not only Dylan and his mother, but also the other members of the family. Dylan's brother is at an age where at this time of the morning he might typically be watching cartoons while he waits for the school bus to come. Instead, he is asked to restrain Dylan to help prevent the self-injurious behavior. This scene is the same as the beginning scene, except that Dylan has now undergone 3 months of intensive treatment, and his parents have been trained to implement the treatment. Mom's about to make lunch. Before she does, she puts out a card to signal to Dylan that he can have her attention, but for appropriate behavior. Dylan doesn't speak, so he hands a card to his mother that shows he and his mother playing together. Now, rather than holding on to him and attending to him all day long, she gives him 1 minute of high-quality attention.
Can Dylan speak ball? Can Dylan speak ball? Yeah. Can Dylan speak ball?
Dylan is about to gesture to his mother with his left hand, and he wants her to go to the play area with him. There he goes. Now Mom will signal back and tell Dylan that he has to wait.
Hey Dylan, have to wait.
Now Dylan is able to separate from his mother and go and play independently while his mother makes lunch, something he was never able to do before treatment.
So the process that we went through with Dylan was pretty typical. The first thing we do is what we call a functional analysis to try and understand what is the purpose of his behavior. And for Dylan, it wasn't too hard to figure out that the purpose of his behavior was to gain and maintain his mother's constant attention. Now, probably someday we may also find out that there's a biological-driven reason that somebody would want that much attention all the time. But for him, that was what was motivating his behavior. And armed with that information, we then used it to design his intervention. We taught him that he could gain attention through an appropriate behavior, handing over a picture card, and that self-injurious behavior no longer produced attention. Once we did that, we had a child that wasn't hitting himself or banging his head, but he was still demanding constant attention. Anytime he wasn't getting attention from his mother or another adult, he was handing over the picture to get it. And that wasn't a practical treatment for his parents or for a teacher to do in the school. So the next step in the process was to teach Dylan, you can't always get what you want. We did that through a variety of procedures. The first thing we did was to play the Rolling Stones song, and that didn't seem to do anything. So the next thing we did was to teach Dylan when that card was out and available, it worked like magic. He could hand it over and he would get immediate attention. But if we put that card away, attention was unavailable. And initially we'd put the card away for just a few seconds at a time, and we gradually increased that so that when he was discharged, the card came out once every 15 to 30 minutes and he could exchange it for 1 minute of high quality attention. And that was a schedule of reinforcement his mother could easily maintain in the home, a teacher could easily maintain in the classroom. And so at that point, we had Dylan where he wasn't demanding constant attention. And a fairly unique thing about him is once we got to that point, we figured out he had absolutely no independent leisure skills. He didn't know how to entertain himself when an adult wasn't at his beck and call. So we literally had to teach him how to play by himself and how to develop some independent leisure skills. Now, these kids with severe behavior disorders are the ones that cost absolutely the most, can easily cost over $8 million over a lifetime, and keeping just one such child out of chronic care pays for treatments for others more, for hundreds more. And our treatment approach for this group is when we say we have to reduce their behavior by at least 80%, make it practical for the home, we're able to do that in over 80% of cases. And this just shows you an example of cost savings. This was somebody I started working with in 1986 at Hopkins when I was a postdoc, and he had been approved for residential treatment, but there wasn't a bed available. So we began working with him on an outpatient basis. He was admitted a couple of times to the inpatient unit, and over about a two-year period, the cost of treatment was about $86,000 we figured this out in 1996 dollars. And if I just told you it cost $86,000 to treat one individual, you'd say that's incredibly expensive, and it is. But the alternative was $150,000 a year in residential treatment costs that would go on and on and on and on over his lifetime. It's now been over 25 years, so the cost of the residential program would probably be closer to $3.75 million. He lives at home. He has a job. He travels on bus to his work, comes home. He helps out around the house. His mother has called me periodically. The last couple of times she's called me, she's concerned that he's interested in girls. And said, that's not a problem. So what do we do? Well, we've talked about diagnosing kids with autism, and that's really a structural approach. How do things look? How do symptoms co-vary? When we look at behaviors like these severe behaviors, we really want to take a functional approach. What is it that the behavior is doing? What's its function? What is its outcome? Is it producing? And so we use functional analysis to identify the environmental context in which aberrant behavior is likely and unlikely to occur, identify the consequences that may be reinforcing or maintaining the behavior, and then we can use that information to prescribe effective treatments. And typical things that we look at, but we have many other things as well, are individuals do this to get attention, to get access to preferred objects. If you think about somebody that's banging themselves, poking themselves in the eye, a parent's going to do just about anything to try and figure out, what do I need to do to get this child to calm down? They may give the child a drink, may give the child food, may give them their favorite blanket, turn on the TV, turn on the radio. And if this happens over and over again, what the child may learn is, I want my favorite blanket, I want to eat, or that sort of thing, the thing to do is to hit yourself. Now, the kids we work with don't learn this verbally like I just explained it as a rule, but they may learn the association nevertheless. Very frequently, the kids we work with, we can't teach them by standing up at a podium and lecturing. We get behind them, we say, this is how you fold a towel. We take their hands and we help them through that. Now, a child with autism may not like people being so close to them, may not like doing the task, even sitting at a chair, may do something inappropriate, knock the materials off the table, try to bite the therapist, or even hit themselves. And the natural thing for a teacher to do is to back off and give the child a chance to calm down. If that happens over and over again, the child may learn is, if I want these people to go away and leave me alone, the thing to do is to hit yourself. And then finally, we also see kids that do this as a form of sensory stimulation. The first lady that I showed you that did it 20,000 times in one day, that probably was at least partially the reason. When we did a study to look at across the first 100 cases of kids with self-injurious behavior on the neurobehavioral unit at Kennedy Krieger Institute, one of the things that was very striking was among individuals who had significant visual impairments, but who had intact sensory neural pathways, they had a 16 times more likelihood to have self-injurious behavior directed towards the eyes, pushing on their eyes, poking their eyes, hitting himself in the eyes. And the logical explanation of that is that if you're somebody who is deprived of visual stimulation all day long, and you start to hit yourself or poke yourself, you produce visual-like stimulation in the occipital lobes, that may be very reinforcing for someone who's deprived of visual stimulation at all other times. Okay, I wanted to give one example of how we kind of adapt this methodology for individuals who have very significant difficulties and are difficult to understand. This is a young man who was about 17 when we started working with him. Autism, he could speak in 2, 3, sometimes 4-word sentences, very, very limited in how he could interact and talk with people. But he knew all the subway bus routes in the greater Baltimore area. He could read, he could travel independently, he could sort mail, he could take a shopping list, go to the store, make change, buy things, had lots of skills. And for the 2 years prior to seeing us, he had essentially been on house arrest because he had this behavior of going and taking large quantities of oral medication, usually Tylenol or something similar, but if that wasn't available, he'd take whatever was. And his psychiatrist, he'd been in and out of the adolescent psych unit at Hopkins, and his psychiatrist called me and said, we're not having much success. Is this somebody that you would consider taking? And so he was transferred to our inpatient unit. And she had taken, the psychiatrist, she had taken just exquisite notes on all the times where he had been gone to the hospital and that sort of thing. And between that and interviewing his mother, we came up with 3 hypotheses. One was that if he took a large amount of medication, he was rushed in an ambulance to the emergency room, interviewed, checked his pulse, checked everything out. And so there was lots of hoopla and medical excitement, and we wondered whether that was reinforcing this behavior. The second thing is if he took a small amount of medication and his mother knew that he was in no danger, she would give him a lecture. And she would give a lecture like nobody I've ever met before or since. She didn't like how clean we kept the unit, and she didn't like the food we served. And so I was on the receiving end of one of these lectures, and I certainly didn't find it reinforcing. But when we saw him and his mother together, and she would start lecturing him, he would get this sly grin on his face, kind of like, well, I got to her. And so we wondered if that was possibly an unusual form of social attention that was reinforcing the behavior. And then finally, if he took kind of some medication and she wasn't sure, she would call their family physician, and he would typically say, why don't you have him lie down for 20 minutes or so, and if he seems okay, let him go on with his usual activities. If not, bring him in. And so we wondered whether or not, and his daily activities was, mom would give him a whole bunch of chores around the house, cleaning and various things, and she would be in the kitchen doing cooking and other things. And so we wondered whether getting a break from these work activities might be reinforcing the behavior. So we set up our analysis where we had 2 rooms, a classroom where he had work to do, either schoolwork or cleaning, and then we had an adjoining room that we turned into this medication room that was baited with placebos in a pill box, and we'd leave him unsupervised, but we had one-way mirrors into both settings so we could observe his behavior. And In the pill box were four pill bottles, all containing identical placebos, but each pill bottle was colored with a unique colored label, and consuming pills from each pill bottle produced a different consequence, three of which corresponded to our hypotheses. If he took pills from the red label bottle, he was brought up to another medication area. The nurses checked him, put a pulse oximeter on him, checked his blood pressure, you know, listened to his heart, talked to him. If we didn't put him in an ambulance, we couldn't quite afford that, but we did everything up to that point that he would receive. If he took pills from the orange label bottle, his mother gave him a lecture just like she did at home. And if he took pills from the blue labeled bottle, he got to go and lay down for a period of time in his room for roughly 20 minutes like he would under some conditions. And then finally, if he took pills from the yellow bottles, he just had to continue with his work activities. And this just shows the results. And what you see here during the first six or seven sessions, he's sampling the various pill bottles, and then he learns that getting out of the work activity, after that, he always took the pills that resulted in him getting to go and lie down and not have to do any more work. So once we had that information, we were set up a program where he was allowed to, he earned preferred non-work activities for completing his scheduled activities and also for turning in pills. And he was required to complete his least preferred activity, which turned out to be shoe polishing, if he ingested pills. And this just shows you his baseline. He's taking somewhere between 2 and up to about 18 pills per minute. So he's popping them in there pretty rapidly. We explain the new rules to him, and his behavior immediately decreases to 0. We go back the reverse, and he doesn't believe us that we're going back to the old rules, but eventually his behavior comes back up. And we reintroduce treatment, and this time he tests the contingencies. So now we have a treatment that works under a highly controlled hospital situation. But what we really wanted is to get him back to a point where he could travel in the community, do things independently. And so we gradually exposed him to different settings in which he was observed and supervised less. And our detection methods were gradually faded. Initially, we had other classrooms where we could observe him, gave him work activities to do in there. Then we started to go to places where we didn't have observation, but we would bait the area with pill bottles that had a residue on it. If he touched those, it turned his hands blue, and we'd implement the contingencies based on whether he had blue hands or not. And then we started to go into the community. We went to a pharmacy where we knew the pharmacist, and we could watch through their CCT video cameras, and he would have to walk by the Tylenol, go and purchase something and leave. We practiced a variety of things like that. Until when he was discharged, he would come in once per week. He would get a tox screen. If he passed his tox screen, he had all sorts of privileges, money, coins for the subway, and he could do things that week. If he didn't, he immediately had to polish shoes, and then he was on restrictions for the following week. And this was something that basically kept him alive. We followed him for about 2 years post-discharge. Now, we're at 1 o'clock. I had some more translational stuff. You sure? Keep going? So another area where we have tried to take research, basic research on learning and apply it to our populations has been in the area of choice. And basically what research shows is that across different organisms, we see that if somebody can earn the same amount of reward, the same amount of food, but in one case you can earn it using several different responses and several different options, and the other one you only get one option, but you get the same outcome either way. Organisms prefer having multiple options or having choices, if you would, than having no choice. And a number of interventions that we've developed have kind of built choice into the preparation, and we did that because what we wanted was people to always choose reinforcers that are going to be effective at that moment in time. But then we discovered that it's not just that they're choosing things that they like at that moment in time, but they like having the opportunity to choose. And so we've begun to look at that. And again, the early stuff was done with animals, and it's always important to know that sometimes we can generalize from animals to humans and sometimes we can't, as Mark Twain has pointed out. And so the goal of the first study was to determine whether individuals with disability preferred a choice to a no-choice condition when each produced the same terminal reinforcers. And this just shows our preparation where we had the individuals responding on different keys, and each one was correlated with a different reinforcement contingency. One was if the child responded on one of them, they got to select what they were going to receive as a reinforcer after about 30 seconds of work. On the no choice, the therapist essentially chose for them, but we yoked what they chose to the child's choices in the previous session. So they basically got the same outcome. And then the third condition was correlated with extinction. And this is Lauren's data, and it's representative of all the participants in this study. You see a very strong preference, almost exclusive, in this case, the first phase, exclusive responding on the key that produced choice. When we go to lower preference stimuli, even with lower preference stimuli, having a choice still made a huge difference. We went to a mixture of LP and higher preference and lower preference stimuli, and you still see a very, very strong effect where choice actually adds to the reinforcement value of the chosen stimulus. The second thing we wanted to look at was kind of testing the limits of this, because one of the things we want people to do is not just to value choice and make choices, but also be able to judge and determine when I would be better off if I let somebody else choose for me. And we wanted to try this out with individuals with disabilities. My analogy is I'm terrible at picking stocks, and I've learned that if I let somebody else pick stocks for me, it produces a better financial outcome. And so in this preparation, we had, again, a choice condition where the child selects, but the only thing they could select between was two lower preference stimuli. And then in our no choice condition, the therapist selected for them, but on 50% of trials, they selected a higher preference stimulus. So they got a better reinforcer about half the time if they let the therapist choose for them. And again, we had a control condition that was just extinction. And so what you see, this is the prior condition where choice produces equal consequences, and we see that preference for choice. We then go to a condition where if you let the therapist choose with you, you produce a better outcome, and the person switches over to the one where they let the therapist choose for them. We go back to where it's equal outcomes both places, and they go back to having a preference for choice. And then when we go back to the final phase where letting somebody else choose for you produces a better outcome, we see the switch over for Lauren. And again, this was replicated with all the participants in this investigation. Now, I had one more that I wanted to show you that kind of using this sort of methodology to analyze very unusual behavior. And so we had a young guy with autism and real, real strong oppositional behavior that if you kind of did something for him or made a choice for him, gave him a toy and said, here, try this one, he would very frequently throw it down and just do whatever was opposite of what we wanted him to do, even if, like in that previous study, it looked like it was in his best interest to let somebody else choose for him. And so we set up a similar preparation. And in this one, one of his high preference items were Coke. And in the choice condition, he could select between multiple identical 1 ounce cups of Coke, and in the no choice condition, the therapist would select from him from a whole bunch of 1 ounce cups of Coke, and then we had the control condition. So we started out in a similar preparation where we had equal VI schedules in both the choice and no choice condition, and he consistently responded on the key that produced letting him choose. And then we essentially raised the price of the choice. What do I mean by that? Well, we started to keep the no choice condition where the therapist chose for them at a VI 15. He would do about 15 seconds of work and then get a 1 ounce cup of Coke. But we started to gradually increase how much work he had to do in order to keep making the choices for himself. And so what you see here at the end, he's working for 10 minutes for a 1 ounce cup of Coke that he can choose himself rather than getting one every 15 seconds where somebody else was making the choice for him. I would say that this is a very strong demonstration of psychopathology in quantitative terms. We haven't seen too many individuals like that, so this was kind of a single case thing. But we have seen a number of individuals where kids with autism will have very strong behaviors like this, where we see them responding to be able to be in control, to have choices, and very frequently doing it so that they can access ritualistic behavior or stereotypic behavior. To give you an example, we had a young man whose parents would take him every night go into the living room, and he would kind of guide his mother to get under his head, kind of like a pillow, and then dad would be on his hands and knees over him. I'm not a Freudian, but I think that was a blanket. And they would stay like that for up to 45 minutes until he fell asleep, and then they would put him to bed. Because if they didn't, he went to real, real severe headbanging and significant behaviors. And they had dozens, literally dozens of these rituals that they would do with him, because if they didn't comply with his rituals, he would display these really severe problem behaviors. And so we analyzed this, developed a treatment for dealing with this, taught him to tolerate periods where he couldn't dictate how people were going to respond to him. But this basic preparation of how kids choose and what they choose, we think, and it has had for us some really interesting findings, as well as being able to come up with some unique and very effective interventions. And with that, I will stop and open it up for questions.
I told Wayne yesterday, I had a special education degree that was behavioral from the University of Pittsburgh, and we were not allowed to use the words think or feel for a whole year. So he brought back all those memories of charts. But Pep, I don't know, do you have any thoughts about Monarch? Are these kids that you see or not see, or are they in different places in Cleveland?
We definitely see kids with various.
Oh, can you put your, you should be able to put that on so we can hear you.
I said we have kids with very severe behaviors, headbanging included, and probably because we're not specifically observant enough, one of the big problems that we have is aggressive behavior that doesn't seem to follow a pattern and has no real identifiable antecedent. So we have occasionally staff injuries because a child will headbutt just in the middle of a session, and the result is pretty severe. And so we get these kinds of behaviors that are kind of, they're aggressive, impulsive, and they're hard to predict.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say that there are kids of that variety, and it was pretty humbling for me at Hopkins when we would see kids prior to their admission, and the admission person was a therapist who then got into doing the clearance with insurance and that sort of thing, and she was an excellent clinician, and she had this standard joke with me saying that we always had to have a mix of people so that you couldn't have too many guys on the unit at one time that were my size, and you know, we're going to overpower the staff sort of thing, and so you always had to have this balancing act. And she would always say, well, this is one that's really, really operant, no biological influencers or anything, it's going to be real clear cut. And we would see the kids for an evaluation, look at their behavior, and try to predict what was going to come out of our analyses, and we were incredibly bad at it. It was really humbling to say, until we do the analyses, in most of these cases, you know, there's some that you can, some kids it's very obvious that behavior is to get attention or something like that, or but in a lot of these severe cases, it's more complex than that. Until you do the analyses, it's very hard. And even in some cases, you have, you know, we've had a number of kids where we bring them in, we do the functional analysis, we reduce their behavior, and then we're seeing episodic behavior that probably has a more biological component, and it may be correlated with agitation or something that, such that it may be easier to find the right medication once you've reduced the operant part of their behavior. And you may be describing folks of that, you know, that's a possibility as well. But so I've certainly, I'd give two points. One is that I view thinking and feeling as behavior. And so I don't have any problem with people talking about that. And also, we work very closely with psychiatrists and developmental pediatricians. We have a joint clinic where we see kids who need both medicine and behavioral intervention. And if we're going to adjust a medication, we hold everything constant behaviorally. We have measures in place to see what's happening. And the same thing, if we're going to be analyzing something behaviorally, we ask the physician to hold things constant in terms of medication. And that sort of approach, where we make one change at a time and systematically assess it, really helps to keep kids on hopefully the right medication and the right dose. And not, you know, we see a lot of kids that come in on 6 and 7 medications, and not all of them are working. I can guarantee that. Yep.
I have a question. Yep. Have you looked into headbanging as a need for some kind of sensory input? In other words, instead of it being, so if behavior is communication, then the child's communicating frustration, anger, need for releasing pressure, whatever it is. And so then, have you looked into that?
Sure.
As that, a solve the problem?
Yeah, so we have a number of, roughly about 25% of the kids that we see with headbanging, there appears to be that sensory stimulation to the occipital lobes can be one. Our kids that we see with pica very frequently, it's oral stimulation is a potent reinforcer. And we try to do the analyses to figure out whether it has what we would call an automatic reinforcement component. And if it does, what is the nature of that? And in the vast majority of cases, we can start to figure out what is that. And we have what we call a competing items assessment. And we have the individual, we try different forms of stimulation, different reinforcers, and we measure how much they interact with what we're giving them and how much do they engage in the self-stimulatory behavior. And we're looking for items that we say compete, meaning that we have high levels of item interaction and low levels of problem behavior. And those are very useful for intervening with individuals of that type. We also have what we call match stimuli, so that if a child is engaging in behavior, we had a case where this guy would break things. And he would break things and break things and break things, and then he would tap on them and break things and tap on them. When he got just the one that made the right sound, he would engage in tapping. And so we did assessments to figure out what can we do that looks a little more socially appropriate in terms of tapping and also prevented the property destruction that would precede his tapping behavior, his stereotypic tapping behavior. Yeah?
I just wanted to say, at Monarch, we have, you know, like all the other programs, we have a whole range of kids with autism, but there certainly is that category of kids who have these severe behavioral difficulties. And like the other programs, our behavior team that's led by several BCBAs looks at behavior in terms of the FBA and, you know, recognizing that all of this behavior has meaning and we have to figure it out. But we also equally weighted to the behavioral approach is a speech and language approach, so that for so many of the kids, some of their behaviors may have stemmed from their communication deficit. So we've really joined together our language department with the behavioral department. And I think when we let go of either one of those, we miss the boat.
Yeah, I would agree. We have a speech and language person that consults with our program and is also part of our diagnostic team. Yeah, and a big part of what we do is functional communication training types of approaches. And sometimes we have to balance things both ways, so that if we try to get somebody to advance too far in their communication, and we're trying to give them a communication response that's more sophisticated, but it's one that they may switch back to using problem behavior in order to get access to a preferred item or to get out of a task or that sort of thing. Sometimes a simpler response will produce a better outcome behaviorally, and then we gradually work towards building their skills more generally. But yeah, so I agree. You have to work both ways at those things. Yeah.
Most of the positive tests that you
Sure. What are the factors with these severe cases that lead, that predict who's going to respond well and that sort of thing? So one thing is when we do our functional analysis and or other analyses, if we can find situations, environmental situations, in which the behavior is essentially at zero, that is a good predictor. If we have somebody that, you know, across all environmental situations, we may get it lower in some, but we can never get it at or close to zero. Those are kids that are more difficult. Other group that is very, very difficult are these kids that have the cyclical behavior, where you know, we have low rates and things are going well, and all of a sudden we have a real strong escalation in their behavior. I have a whole presentation about cyclical behavior disorders in nonverbal individuals, but it's one of the most treatment resistant, both in terms of medication management, but also, and also in terms of behavioral treatment. It's not that we can't get there with those, but it you work at it, you work at it, you work at it, and you know, you can have them stable for sometimes a year, and then something happens. We had one girl that I worked with for many years in Atlanta, and she was doing really, really well, very, very severe self-injury, and got a broken leg, went into the hospital, had, you know, very good care for her leg, but not very good care for her self-injurious behavior in the hospital. And as a result, you know, it was basically back to square one in her treatment. Good questions.
I wonder if you could address a little how you, what you were doing with the insurers, because that might affect a lot of people here as well.
Okay.
And if you want to ask a question, you can.
Okay, so we do a number of things. One is to, when we went to Atlanta, when we went to Omaha, we tried to set up meetings with the Medicaid folks in the state, with the medical directors of insurance providers, and essentially give our dog and pony show. Here's why you should cover this. And for the feeding disorders program, it's actually easier than severe behavior, and that is because treating somebody for a severe behavior, for a feeding disorder, can prevent surgery for tubes. Kathleen, if she gets somebody, if they're cleared to be an oral feeder and they're scheduled for surgery, if she can get them before they go to surgery, she has a 90% success rate for preventing the need for surgery. And that saves about $135,000 over a 5-year period of time, but actually saves money in the very first year. And it's hard to get insurance companies to think about savings more farther out than about a year or at most two. But she can do that, and it's a little bit easier for her. With the severe behavior disorders, it's tougher because the insurance providers, if they pay for the treatment, that's great. If they don't pay for the treatment and it's going to cost a lot more later, it generally costs a lot more later to the state. That is, those folks end up in long-term care, they end up on Medicaid or Medicare, and they cost the state a lot of money. So the financial incentives are tougher with insurance providers under that situation. But we work with them, and I think the tide is really changing in terms of people, insurance companies realizing that they have to do this. The insurance mandates through Autism Speaks and others have really helped. We now have utilization review protocol that we've developed that's being used several places around the country to work with insurance companies to say, this is somebody for whom behavioral treatment and medication management has a place, and you need to pay for it. And so the thing we used to get is somebody has severe self-injury and they have autism, and they would say, well, our policy excludes treatment of autism. And I'd say, I'm not treating autism, I'm treating self-injurious behavior. And they say, it's all a part of autism, because kids with autism are more likely to have self-injurious behavior. And I say, kids with autism are more likely to have seizures. Do you deny treatment of seizures based on the diagnosis of autism? And of course, they don't. But we would fight back and forth. And I think over time, we've been winning that argument. And you know, we make the point that what you're engaging in is a big problem, what we call diagnostic masking. A person has mental retardation, so you attribute all their problems to mental retardation. Or a person has autism, and they can't have any other dual diagnosis or other psychiatric condition. That's ridiculous. And we've made progress on that. And so we're doing much better at getting kids cleared for these intensive outpatient and day treatment programs. At the Kennedy Krieger Institute, the inpatient unit is always full because they take the most severe from anywhere and everywhere. And so that program actually is a money-making program for the Kennedy Krieger Institute. But it is a big thing to run 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Yeah.
Do schools have any responsibility if these are school-age kids who are in your home area, for example, given IDEA and other requirements? Do they have any responsibility?
Yes. So they have a responsibility to provide a fee-free and appropriate education. And if that involves a child with diabetes needing insulin during the day, they have to have a school nurse and they have to supply that, even though that's would be considered a medical intervention. The same thing applies for treating these severe behavior problems, but it's just a harder thing, so you may have, if the parents have to sue in order to get the treatments, it's very difficult. At the Marcus Institute, we developed a school, and we developed a contract with the state Medicaid. And kids could come in and spend about half of their day in our school and half their day in our clinic. And Medicaid would pay for the half of the day that they spent in the clinic as we developed the treatment. And the school system would pay for the half the day in the school. And that was a pretty good model for the kids that schools really couldn't take care of. But there are lots of kids out there that need treatment. Schools can get them through the 6 hours a day, but the family's still having huge problems, and those kids still need treatment, and insurance is probably, or Medicaid is probably the only option for those types of individuals. But yes, that's a good point. We have also, right now, we have two kids in our day treatment program that are paid for by school systems. And so we've negotiated with the State Department of Education in Nebraska and have a rate negotiated. The schools, if they send somebody to us, they have to pay, but then they can apply at the end of the year to get reimbursed for the state's, whatever their proportion is for special education services across the board, they will reimburse the school that proportion for the kids that come to see us.
That sounds like a very reasonable model, given schools' inability to do more than they can do.
Right.
It sounds like you're pooling the best of both resources.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Dr. Fisher, and I hope I'll see you all soon in November to see Dr. Dolmetsch.